During the last ice age, a huge glacier oozed over Ohio, flattening the land, but making it rich and fertile for forests and farmlands. We were headed further south, to the hills beyond the glacier's reach, where winter thawed to make way for spring's renewal.
Once again, it was time to head out on another adventure. This time around, we were going to Zaleski State Forest in Ohio.
Once we got to the parking lot, we were eager to see what lay ahead. Things are a bit more restricted at this park as you have to stay on the trails and camp at designated locations. But for Ohio, this was a backpacking oasis.
With no fees and just a self-registration kiosk, it's easy to set up a trip here too.
Well, we're finally at the trailhead, but before we go in, I'm gonna collect some of these cattails. They'll be really useful later on.
It helps to have waterproof boots.
Among other things, the bottoms of cattail stalks, their rhizomes, and their pollen can all be eaten. And the dried stalks make a decent friction fire spindle. But if you don't already know, you'll have to wait and see what the cattail head is for.
This trip, I would be arriving late. Andrew and Robby would be taking the main trail camping one night. The next day, I'd be arriving, hiking an alternate trail, and we would be meeting at this campsite. Then we'd hike back out of the park on the final day.
At the trailhead, the gentle swaying of the tall pines and the soft gray sky were contrasted by the cacophonous calls of spring peeper frogs and red-winged blackbirds. Soon after, the pine trees became more scattered, and we wandered into a deciduous woodland.
Eventually, we followed the trail into a small valley with a flowing stream. Frozen cascades clung to rocky outcrops in the hills, and the last glimmer of sunlight illuminated distant trees.
After filling up some water, we took a small detour, which took us to a rock shelter with a beautiful, partially frozen waterfall underneath. You could smell the rejuvenating change of the seasons in the air.
There's a fork in the road, and that's actually the fork that we thought Bryan was taking. But it doesn't look like that's what it actually is, so we're definitely on King Hollow Trail right now, and there's a frozen waterfall as you can see behind us.
Seems like no matter where we go, the map never matches what's actually there.
So we thought we were at this fork with a trail going left on the side trail and a trail to the right. But the sign said otherwise. Right now we took a detour on this King's Hollow Trail just to check out this little area, but I don't know, I'm a bit confused because the sign told us to go back to the left to get to point B. And that is not what it looks like on the map. But I guess we'll just have to follow the sign and see what happens.
Oftentimes, the maps you find at parks aren't of the best quality. It's best to print out maps ahead of time. But in cases like this, where the trails are well marked, we often just trust our gut and keep going. We made our way back to the trail, which we followed up a hill. The sun was soon far below the horizon.
Hopefully you guys will be able to hear it, but the frogs in that bog down there are absolutely deafening.
Little lesson to be learned, always unpack your bag when you come back. I left this in my rucksack for a while and it got thrown around and the battery cover snapped off. Luckily I had a band-aid and gave it a little quick repair. So we should be good to go.
It's essential to have some sort of lighting device when you're out in the wild. Headlamps are the most useful that we've come across, since they're bright, but more importantly, hands-free.
We got some good news,
and we got some bad news. Good news?
Well, we found the junction we were looking for, so we're not lost.
Bad news is that we have a lot longer to hike than we thought. But that's okay, we're used to it by now.
Something about the wilderness makes 1.8 miles seem a lot longer than it actually is.
It was a magical, moonlit night. Because of the filming we did, we had to stop short of reaching the campsite. Although camping anywhere is technically against the rules here. If you're tired and feel that you can't continue without risking injury, and, in our case, also damaging expensive equipment, it's best to just stop and set up camp. Just make sure you leave no trace.
Now that the tent was up, it was time to rummage through the old food sack for some victuals.
An interesting note about anchovies is that they're one of the smallest fish, so they collect the least amount of toxins, such as mercury. The bigger the fish, the more toxins it has.
Okay, so we brought lots of different food. Main thing we brought were these sardines right here. We also brought these almonds. Now nuts go really well with cheese. Cheese, generally, is you just want to get a hard cheese. Don't get something too light like mozzarella to go bad.
I brought some of this cheap ramen. It's very cheap and it's really great camping food if you're just trying to get pure calories. To supplement the ramen, I got some vegetables. Got these canned peas and carrots here. And this bag of spinach, which I actually decided to bring. It'll last for a couple days, especially when weather's sort of colder like this. It's basically like you're outside in a refrigerator, so there's not too much to worry about.
Sauerkraut, it's a fermented food, which means that there's live bacteria in there eating the cabbage. This is actually one of the original ways that ancient cultures used to preserve food. It not only makes the food beneficial to your digestion, but it'll last basically forever.
Of course, you can bring along some fresh produce that generally doesn't go bad and doesn't require refrigeration. Got this nice sweet yam here, and hopefully we're gonna cook that up in a fire tomorrow. And along with the yam, I got this Spam. Don't ask me why I bought it. We're about getting ready to go to sleep, and I wanted to show you this. It's not a hat with a string on it, it's a unisock. Whenever I go camping and I have like one or two or even three pairs of socks on, my feet still get really cold. So the whole idea behind this, you put both your feet in the same sock. And just the way that a mitten warms your fingers up, instead of gloves having all your fingers separate, this should keep my feet really warm at night.
You gonna turn that light off?
Nope. few cardinals serenaded us in the bright, quiet morning, and the brisk air felt incredibly refreshing.
It was a pretty chilly night, but it was really nice to be in this tent, protected from all that wind. Got up in the middle of the night at some point, and all the clouds had gone away. It was very nice and starry. But there was some point where it started raining a bunch. It just seemed like it was gonna last forever. But now, we've got the cardinals chirping, the woodpeckers pecking. It's time to head out.
Our first order of business is gonna be to find some water. We
sort of ran out last night.
We only carried 2 500-milliliter bottles, which is not quite enough for two people.
Hopefully Bryan will be bringing that platypus in.
We should have just taken that platypus. That would have been better.
Tell you what though, my feet were really warm last night with that unisock. One of the best ideas I've ever had.
Seriously though, the unisock worked fantastically.
We had a quick cold breakfast before taking down our camp.
Nice thing about this unisock is it doubles as a stuff sack.
We were especially careful to leave no trace, since we had camped just off of the trail, outside of a designated campsite. We didn't want anybody to see the signs of our campsite in the leaf litter. Speaking of which,
it's mid-March and winter is just ending, but the ground is still covered in all these leaves. In fact, oaks are one of the last to drop their leaves. And there's a bunch of different oaks in this forest. You got your chestnut oak. You got your white oak. And your scarlet oaks. There's also sugar maple leaves on the ground too, but it's just nice to notice these things as you're walking around. And you can also hear in the distance some red-bellied woodpecker chirping and some other birds, nuthatches, things like that.
Along with designated campsites, this park has restroom facilities and water pumping stations. Convenient, but we find them to be aesthetically displeasing, and frankly unnecessary, especially since squatting when it's business time is much better for your health.
I was worried when I heard that they had specific watering areas, that it'd be some bad tasting water, but not bad at all. Spotted this guy from the watering hole not too far from here. And this is called rattlesnake plantain. It kind of resembles the rattlesnake rattle. And I've seen these in the Smokies. I didn't expect to find them this close in Ohio, but here they are.
The rattlesnake plantain shares many of the medicinal properties also found in its cousin, the common or greater plantain.
This you find a lot in lawns and stuff like that. But you can use it as sort of a band-aid for your finger. Or you can chew it up and put it in wounds to heal it.
Common or greater plantain is also fantastic for rashes and bug bites.
It was the second day, and as we made our way southeast, Bryan would be entering the trailhead and taking the side trail northeast. As we hiked, we passed the campsite we were originally planning staying the previous night.
Well, this is campsite C here, but it's too late for that now. We're on our way to Point F to camp there, and hopefully Bryan will be meeting us there, so long as everything goes to plan.
So the plan was that my brother and my cousin leave for Zaleski Friday, and they would hike to the first campsite since I had to work. So I am leaving today, Saturday, and I will hike from the parking lot to the second campsite, which is about 3.8 miles, and I will meet up with them there, which is a pretty good plan. It'll give me some time to hike by myself, which I really don't get to do very often, for about 3.8 miles, which is, you know, a good enough time to really enjoy it, but not to get the feeling of loneliness, so I'm looking forward to it.
In the meantime, I decided to ID some trees as we hiked.
This is a dogwood tree, and you can tell because the bark has all these tiny little flakes on it, and it's also opposite branching up there, meaning the twigs come out at the same point. It's also got these really big buds. In the summer, you can test with the leaf and see if there's sort of a latex inside by pulling it apart. But obviously right now there's no leaves to be found, so. But it's a very beautiful tree. A lot of people use it as ornamental stuff in their yard.
Sometimes I get a bit carried away.
Shagbark hickory. Sugar maple. White oak. All favorites of mine.
And it's not just trees. There are plenty of wild edibles to be found here, even this early in the spring.
This is bear corn, and I think they call it that because it looks like corn that a bear digested. But later in the summer, it has a more yellowish sort of pale color, and it's actually edible. Right now, though, you probably couldn't do too much with it. This is spice bush, and what gave it away are these little round buds. And if you scrape the bark off, it's got a very fragrant smell. If you ever are in need of a good hot cup of tea, you can just collect some of these twigs, scrape some of the bark into a cup, and drink up. Really good on a cold day. Nice to see all these plants coming out. Good sign that spring is on its way. This is clover. And it's actually an edible plant. It doesn't have much of a taste, but something to know. It's kind of got a slight tart, leafy taste. It's not bad at all.
But it's still too early in the year to get any significant food from foraging. We sat down and had our lunch.
So I'm getting closer to Zaleski. We're in Hockey Hills. The weather today has just been amazing. We've been really lucky with the weather. I mean, just look at this. And I'm really looking forward to getting back on the trail. It's been a long time. The entire winter, we really weren't able to do any sort of hiking or backpacking just because of our schedules and our lives. So even getting on the trail for just a weekend will be really nice.
We struggled up the steep trail and had to scoot over fallen logs. The trail seemed like it would keep going on forever, but just as soon, it winded back downhill. Thank you.
came to a beautiful overlook and gazed out at the horizon.
After that, the trail bent back around and took us down into a valley. We stopped at a stream for water while Bryan started out on the trail.
So I finally reached Zaleski State Forest. You can see the road over there. That's the road I just took in. And there's the parking lot. This trail, I'm going to be following these orange blazes, which signifies the main trail, for a bit. And then there's a side trail which has some white blazes. But already, I'm just starting to feel invigorated, getting like the soft earth under my feet and seeing all the pine needles on the ground. And I'm really excited to get this hike going and meet up with them too. We never really agreed on a time to meet up at the campsite since it's kind of hard to coordinate. I think it's about 3:40 right now, but we do have our portable radios so that when we start nearing the campsite we can try and communicate with each other to let us know that we're close. I guess it's time to head out into the wilderness. See you guys in a bit.
Into this area, we actually think we weren't making it very good on time. We want to get to the next campsite before dark. We've got this lake right here, and according to the map, we're actually pretty close to at least the next scenic point. So that's not too far from the campsite, and it's very beautiful, as you can see.
All around this boggy area are these birch trees, and they've got this really nice papery bark. And like the cattail from earlier, that's going to come into use later.
The beavers have also made good use of these river birches. When collecting birch bark, be sure not to strip the bark down too deeply, and never peel bark off from around the entire tree. It's best to take pieces that are already flaking off to prevent harming it.
We took a brief detour to check an abandoned railroad marked on the map.
We stopped to eat some food and wondered how Bryan was doing so far.
Spotted these while we were eating. They've actually got a very relevant purpose right now. It looks like grass, but it's actually chives. It's got a very good onion taste. I think I might have some of that cheese with it.
You can also pull the bulbs up and that's just like a green onion pretty much. Really delicious. Try this out.
We're gonna enjoy this cheese with some chives. Drop my nuts. Cheese and chives. Got a splinter and we don't have any pins or anything to get it out with. So Andrew carved me this knife right here, or not knife, but this point with his knife. And you'd be surprised at how well this is actually working. This is just a sharp stick. Gotta stick it in here, pull up the skin here. Splinter is now exposed, so I could probably just dig it out with my hand at this point. And it's clear. And it's clear now and feels much better.
You're not going to have every tool you need when you're out in the wild, but a little creative thinking solves most problems. After that little break, it was more hiking. For us and Bryan.
It's really steep.
Got these little walkie-talkies. I've got it on now, and I'm pinging them every few minutes to see if we're in range yet.
Oh, you're not there yet. Okay.
Awesome. Oh, I hope that camera was still recording.
Okay, Bryan, do you read me?
Okay, we're gonna keep moving in closer to see if we can hear you a little bit better.
Let's move up, let's move up.
Just made a first contact with Andrew and Robby over the radios. Let's see if I can. Yeah, I read you. Can you hear me? Okay, that's fantastic. I'm actually still probably, I want to say maybe 1.5 miles away.
Repeat that last message.
I was saying I'm not 100% sure, but I think I'm still about 1.5 miles away from the campsite.
Roger that.
We are actually at the campsite at this moment.
All right, we're going to be at
campsite Delta, right?
Correct.
All right, copy that. I will let you know
when I'm approaching closer.
Roger that. We'll leave the walkie-talkie on. We got extra batteries. Over.
Several nuthatches called from above in the trees, as though sharing our excitement. But it was time to settle down and set up camp.
We anxiously awaited Bryan's arrival. As goofy as it sounds, having successfully used the walkie-talkies to make contact with Bryan was really exciting. All of this incredibly complex technology really boils down to achieving the same goal we've been after for thousands of years, connecting to each other.
A lot of hard work setting that tent up.
How you doing, Bryan?
I'm doing good. I think I'm nearing 7.
Roger that. We got the tent set up, we're ready for you.
No signs of him yet.
Whoop, whoop.
Whoop,
whoop. Oh. Oh, we see you, we see you.
Yo, you got trouble finding your way around? Yeah,
the hardest half a mile.
That last stretch seemed like it was the hardest.
Oh man, it was tough.
I had originally expected a leisurely hike to the campsite, but the constant ups and downs of the trails ended up tiring me out quickly. I was grateful to reach the campsite and began setting up my tent so I could ease my weary feet.
There's something so therapeutic about processing wood for a fire. It's hard to explain to anybody who hasn't done it, but splitting and shaving wood is incredibly enjoyable. Speaking of which, are you ready to find out what those cattails are for?
So this is all that cattail stuff that I collected the other day, and it's actually broken up on its own as we've hiked. I've also got some of this river birch bark here, and I'm just gonna put these sticks that I've shaved on the pile. And the thing about cattails is they're a really, really, really good source of tinder. And you don't even need a match or a lighter. Just like that.
Cattails are one of the best sources of tinder, and the great thing is that they're available through the cold season, when a fire is most important. Their thin, dried leaves are also fantastic kindling.
If you've ever got a big piece of wood that you can't break with just your leg, here's a little trick you can do. Find a wedged tree here. It's easy. And you can keep going, depending on how old the wood is and how long it is.
It was time for some of that cheap ramen. I don't recommend you try this at home. I'm a professional Asian.
Well, along with that, we're gonna be cooking this yam in here. Just gotta scoop these embers on top.
Time for a little classic camp cooking. Some sliced spam on a stick. I've always wondered what canned, compressed, processed meat tastes like.
I haven't wondered.
Let's give these a little slice and dice. It feels really dense and thick, actually. It's coming out. Give this a go. Quite good, really good. Okay, time to add a bit of vegetables. Now again, we brought this bag of fresh spinach. And it smells just fine still. It's been pretty cold, so I think it's not too different from refrigerator. And this should shrink down immensely once it's cooked.
While we cook the spam over the fire, Bryan fried his piece in a can, using some of this leftover sardine oil.
Probably need to pour more.
Get some of them veggies. It's a bit full. I'm gonna put some sardines in there too, though. Just to top it off.
As the sun fell beyond the hills, we continued sitting, talking, and eating with each other around the fire.
That's gonna warm you up. That's good. Right. We started with spam, now we end it with yam.
Moonlight illuminated the forest, and we basked in it for a while before retiring to our tents.
One thing we all struggle with in our society is sleeping in a natural rhythm with day and night. Out here, though, it's just so much easier to relax and enjoy the night and let your body fall easily into sleep after enjoying the cool night air.
Good night.
You gonna leave that light on again?
Yep. Despite the warm weather and the sun we had yesterday, today was a stark contrast of climate. It was frigid and gray. This is where having fast and easy tinder comes to use. A group of Boy Scouts that had also camped in the same location left early in the morning, a more prudent decision than our choice to stay behind by the fire. Our hope that the sun would warm up the day quickly disappeared.
It's a lot colder today, probably in the 30s. Certainly feels like it, maybe 40s. But when it's cold like this,
one of the good things to do is just to start getting moving.
Get everything packed up, get your blood flowing. It's tempting to stay by the fire all morning, and we did that, but once you get moving, that also helps warm you up.
An added benefit of the unisock is that, believe it or not, it doubles as a hat. Something that I definitely need today.
We overcame our reluctance and finally put our boots to the trail.
Difficult it was to hike up there, and they contacted me, and I was here. It took me like what, 15 minutes, 20 minutes to get all the way from here up to the campsite.
Probably took longer than that, actually.
Whereas it took us like, you know, maybe half the time just coming down. I think the desire to keep moving and stay warm is definitely pushing us.
We got more muddy dirt trails to go on.
Gotta get started.
Let's move out.
It was a bit of a tough hike, but we were fortunate that the hilly terrain kept us warm on this cold and cloudy day.
Eventually, the trail led us to a wide gravel path, where some trees had been cut down. Not the most inspiring landscape, but at least it was easy hiking.
Probably why they tell you to camp only at the campsites. As much as I like camping off the trail and having a fire anywhere, you always gotta clean up after yourself. I guess it is kind of ironic to say that in an area with a gravel path and logging going on, but I think regardless, I'm gonna pack this up.
The bitter wind and the frozen falls were a constant reminder that winter still clung to the land around us.
But it's the cold of winter that allows you to truly experience all aspects of nature. How could we even know what warmth was if it wasn't for the cold? As Alan Watts says, the hardness of a rock is literally what allows your skin to be soft.
made it back to the trail junction. And before long, the parking lot was within our sight.
It was the end of the trip, and as much as we loved it here, we didn't feel sad. The end of this journey felt like the beginning of something new. Like the spring flowers that were soon to bloom, we knew we had many more adventures to come in our future.